Hiya, you filthy animals. Every time I do a thing about Zazen, I get some... There's sort of a typical sort of complaint. One is, oh my god, you said you have to do it in lotus posture! Nobody can do it in lotus posture! So you don't have to do Zazen in the full lotus posture. There are several other optional postures that are available to you if you want to do Zazen and you can sit on a cushion. Number one is the half lotus posture, which we're showing here. Number two is the Burmese posture. This is what I do. Number three, you can sit on a seiza bench. Here's a seiza bench picture. Number four is a chair. But wait. Okay. Now, as soon as you mention that you can do Zazen on a chair, especially in these here United States, everybody is rushing to the chairs. I've been to so many centers where I see perfectly able-bodied people sitting Zazen on a chair. Sometimes they're like this. This is their meditation. I swear to God, I've seen places where the meditators, half of them are like leaned up against chairs or the walls like this, meditating. This is my meditation. That's not meditation. Now, about doing Zazen in chairs, here's my favorite analogy. If I were to write a book about playing bass, or Geddy Lee were to write a book about playing bass, or the late John Entwistle were to write a book, or Paul McCartney, or Jack Bruce, or anybody wrote a book about playing bass, they would assume that the audience that they were writing for had 10 fingers, and they would write the book just with the assumption that everybody reading it has 10 fingers. Now, not everybody has 10 fingers. Some people have 8 fingers, some people have 2 fingers. There's all sorts of things that can happen in this world where people end up not having 10 fingers. But you don't write the book with another chapter on how to do it with 9 fingers, and another chapter how to do it with 8 fingers, and you assume that the person who has less than 10 fingers and really wants to play bass, they'll find a workaround of their own. That's what sitting in chairs is about. Sitting chairs is for people who cannot sit on a cushion. You're going to have a much better Zazen if you're able to sit Zazen on a cushion. You're going to have a much better Zazen on the cushion. If your legs just don't bend that way, don't worry, you can still do it, but you can sit on a chair. And here's a couple of pictures on doing Zazen sitting on a chair. I also met a guy in Minnesota, a Zen teacher out there, who sits on one of those ergonomic kneeling benches like this. And he does his Zazen on one of those, which I think is actually better than a chair. So those are workarounds, but those are workarounds for people who cannot sit on the floor. The thing is, what you want to do is have your spine straight vertically without any support. And the best way to do that is on a cushion on the floor. Those other ways of doing it are workarounds for people who can't do it on the cushion on the floor. What sitting on a chair does is it makes your butt flat, which makes your back, so let's try to do it, your back want to lean. And what you want to do is tilt your butt so that your back is straight. That's a normal way to sit. You think about it, in nature, things like chairs don't really exist very much. You're going to be sitting on a log or a rock or something, and it's going to make your butt and hips bend a little forward. Chairs are kind of a weird, unnatural thing to sit on, and they don't allow your spine to go straight up and down, and that's really important for doing Zazen. And the other question I get is when people hear about Shikantaza, they're like, oh my god, I can't do Shikantaza, I have to do a preliminary practice. And there's all sorts of preliminary practices out there that are recommended for people, and they're, you know, some of them are okay or whatever. But if you do Dogen's style of Zazen, you heard Fukan Zazengi last time if you watched my previous video. He doesn't say anything about counting your breaths. He doesn't say anything about contemplating a koan. He doesn't say anything about inquiring, who am I? He doesn't say anything about listening to a guided meditation, you know, or scanning your body. He gets you right into Shikantaza straight from day one. That's the Soto Zen style. I mean, some people modify it, but that's Soto Zen. That's how we do it. You know, if it's not for you, then maybe you go somewhere else. That's fine. And maybe you'll have a good time there. But this is the Soto Zen style that I teach. Here's what Dogen has to say about those sort of preliminary practices. This is from Dharma Hall Discourse number 390, and it's Dogen's extensive record, Eihei Koroku, and the translators entitle this one, How to Breathe in Zazen. In the Zazen of patched-robed monks, first you should sit correctly with upright posture. Then regulate your breath and settle your mind. In the lesser vehicle, originally there were two gateways, which were counting breaths and contemplating impurity. Contemplating impurity is sort of that mind-scanning stuff. In the lesser vehicle, people used counting to regulate their breath. However, the Buddha ancestors' engaging of the way always differed from the lesser vehicle. A Buddha ancestor, which in this case happens to be Nagarjuna, said, "Even if you arouse the mind of a leprous wild fox, never practice the self-regulation of the two vehicles." That's pretty strong. So even if your mind is going crazy, don't count your breaths. That's what he says. And then he says, "In the Mahayana, there is also a method for regulating breath, which is knowing that one breath is long, another breath is short. The breath reaches the tanden, which is the hara, the diaphragm. Although exhale and inhale differ, both of them occur depending on the tanden. Impermanence is easy to clarify, and regulating the mind is easy to accomplish." So say you. "My late teacher, Tendo Nyojo," this is Dogen speaking, "said, breath enters and reaches the tanden, and yet there is no place from which it comes. Therefore, it is neither long nor short. Breath emerges from the tanden, and yet there is nowhere it goes. Therefore, it is neither short nor long." My late teacher said it like that. Suppose someone were to ask me, "Master, how do you regulate your breath?" I would simply say to him, "Although it is not the great vehicle, it differs from the lesser vehicle. Although it is not the lesser vehicle, it differs from the great vehicle." Suppose that person inquired again, "Ultimately, what is it?" I would say to him, "Exhale and inhale are neither long nor short." And here's a little thing I saw online from Koben Chino, who is my first teacher's teacher. He says, "If you really sense the texture of the inhalation, when the air comes in and how you feel when the air goes out, you will have a different feeling. If you just count the breath, you miss it all. That's too bad. This is a very important moment you are living. There really is no time to count." I was thinking about that this morning as I was doing Zazen. This is a really important moment you are living. There really is no time to count. To me, that was powerful stuff. So I thought, there's no time for counting. I want to pay attention to this moment. And Koben goes on, "Counting is a skill you use to quiet a restless mind, a fast mind, or a cluttered mind. It's very helpful to finish up your breath just before you move into the Zendo. Finish up means you take your finest breath for sitting instead of crashing into the room and starting to sit and beginning work on your breath. That's too late." Kaplo Roshi's book, The Three Pillars of Zen, made counting the breath a popular method of sitting in this country, he means America, because it was one of the few readable texts years ago. But as you sit and get more familiar with your sitting posture and the dynamics of your body and mind, counting your breath becomes a very small part of practice. It is like knitting a sweater during sitting. It's better not to do it. I mean, definitely you have to do it sometime. It can be used as a crutch before you sit. Maybe before the Zendo you can start counting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Straighten your breath, then drop counting right there and sink into sitting. I'm not denying the instructions you had. The means of counting is what I'm talking about. Depending on each person, there is an inner image of what breathing when sitting is. As you notice, there is also a physical element of sitting, and an invisible element of sitting which we call mind. We do mind sitting, body sitting, and we let the breath sit. Three aspects of sitting exist because we can observe our sitting from three angles. We breathe naturally and appreciate our breath and really understand what the breath does to our body and our mind. To really connect the three, body, mind, and breath, is the point, not counting breathing. And then he said in another talk, "The ideal in sitting is to forget the breath. You may breathe as you like. There is an incredible variety in the speed of breathing and even the emotion of breathing. So if you want to observe your breathing, you should do it for months and months without trying to control it." One of the things I have to say about this, and I gave this in a talk I gave in Germany a few years ago, was a friend of mine lives in Munich, and she took me to a place called Eisbach, which means ice river, ice brook. And people surf on this river, and I got some video of it to show you. When I was watching the people surfing, I realized that even the best of them could only stay on their surfboard for a couple of minutes, maybe a minute, maybe 45 seconds. I didn't really time it, but not very long. And then they all fell off. And that's just the nature of the thing. To me, that's kind of the nature of Zazen too. You might have good concentration, you might, you know, have a beautiful experience and it's all wonderful, but at some point you're going to fall off and then you just get back on again. You get out of the water, metaphorically, like in the ice box, and you get back on your surfboard and you get on again. And that's how Zazen goes, I think, for pretty much anybody. If you're looking for the magical Zazen that's just, whoop, you know, on your surfboard forever, it ain't going to happen. So that's my little advice for you today, and I hope it's useful. I don't know, maybe people will be mad at this one too, but if you're mad at me, you can donate. That's a way to get rid of your anger. Donate via PayPal and Patreon. The links are below. That is how I make my living, and it isn't through book royalties or anything like that. It's mainly through your donations, so thank you very much for that, and have good Zazen, and see you later. Bye.